Hey, Jaime.
Hello, Simón.
Hi Gopi, hello Kalpana. So let me wait for 2 more minutes. If there are anyone going to join, let them join. Okay, let me get started then. So last week we just have seen a overview of Spark streaming and one or two examples of running that and getting those messages into the different timestamps. And so a data stream is nothing but a sequence of IDs. So that is the live data getting chopped up into the different batches of seconds. So what is mean by a D-stream? What is a batch? And how does a D-stream can be transformations? And what is a Spark streaming context? And the start and await termination, all these things we have seen. Okay. So whenever the messages are received, they get duplicated in multiple blocks, and the transformed D streams will be again recalculated on the data nodes. And if any one of them is lost, those things will be recalculated. So we talked about bit of transformations there and fault tolerance. And so what are the different types of transformations or the operations? Stateless and stateful. So the stateless, I gave you just an idea that it's your all your regular RDD operations, whatever you have learned so far. Stateful operations are a bit different that you will first time observe in the Spark streaming. So we can discuss that now. So we have seen this linking section and so this example also we have seen. Yeah, and let's start with the execution of Spark streaming architecture onwards. Okay. So whenever you run any driver program that contains driver program means, so that's the one who kickstarts your Spark context. So this is also one example of your driver program. So where you are creating the Spark conf object, and using that conf object, you are creating the Spark context. And using the Spark context, by just specifying the batch window, the batch size with 1 second. So I'm creating the Spark streaming context. So on this, I'm opening a socket text to stream. That means you'll be listening on this so-and-so host name and the port number socket, and listening for text messages. All those things will be captured into this line. And these lines will be filtered out. And whatever that contains the error messages, only those are captured, and those will be printed. So start and await termination. So this is your driver program and streaming context. So once you start your streaming context, Spark jobs to process the received data. So the streaming context will invoke some of the executors or initiate some of the executors on the worker nodes. And on those, it will initiate the receiver tasks. So it will, the tasks will be running there. So tasks, long tasks will be running on the executor JVMs. So those are nothing but your receiver tasks. So the receiver task is responsible for receiving the message from the input stream. Let's say if that is a socket text stream. So this receiver is the one that keeps listening on that socket port number. And if we have configured our Kafka or Twitter, so on that Twitter, this receiver is the one that will keep on monitoring from the source. Once it receives the messages from the input stream, so it, then the data will get replicated to another worker node. So as I was telling, so at least there will be 2 copies of the received data. So data will be replicated to another worker node, and then from that, so once the stream is prepared, then the transformations or any subtasks will be executed on that. Okay, and the same one we can see in the next slide also. So if you observe the left side one as the Spark streaming and the Spark driver, and we have a couple of worker nodes here. So whenever you submit the Spark streaming context.start, yeah, so network input tracker, if it is your socket tracker, for example, I took, so network input tracker. So this will track for the input, the new coming, upcoming input on the network ports. Now, the network receivers. So for this, the network receivers launched as tasks, as I was telling. So a receiver task, receiver itself is one task in the executor. Okay, that receiver task will be running on the worker nodes, some of the worker nodes, how many ever receivers that we can specify. And this receiver will receive the data. So data received and the blocks pushed to. So once the data is received to this, so it has to be stored into in-memory, right? So to store in-memory, in the RAM memory of your JVM of executor, the block manager is the one that is responsible to push those blocks into the RAM memory. And once they are pushed into RAM memory of that particular executor, and the same will get replicated onto another machine's block manager. The blocks get replicated. So once the blocks get replicated, so these will send the notification that once the block is successfully replicated, so notification of received block IDs will be sent back to your driver. So I have received so-and-so block ID. And here in the driver, block manager master service will be there. And so that will get notified with the all the locations of the block IDs. The block manager master will get notified with the all the locations of the block IDs. Okay. So that way it maintains this. This is how the flow happens between your driver and your worker nodes. And coming to the more details of the B streams and receivers. Here in the receivers and B streams, we have two types: the basic sources and advanced sources.
Shiva, I have a question.
Yes.
Okay. So. In the earlier slide, what do you mean by location of the block ID?
Location of a block means in which machine, in which worker node that is present. That is the location.
Okay, so you mean to say the memory location, not hard disk location, right?
No. It's not hard disk. It's not stored in hard disk.
Yeah, that is what I mean. It is not processing.
Not even memory location. In which machine that is stored in. How does your name node stores the locations of your block IDs? Does it store the location of your local file system? No. It stores only in which machine that is present.
Yeah. Okay.
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 So the machine address, so in which machine that is stored, so that will get maintained in the storage block manager master. Okay. And coming to the different input streams, we mainly have two types of input. These streams are depending on the sources. We have basic sources and advanced sources. So basic sources are sources directly available in the streaming context API, where you don't need to download any extra packages or APIs. So when you are using your Spark streaming, example, the file system streaming, the one that we have seen, text file stream, and socket connections. Just now we have seen the socket text stream. And any Akka actors, Akka is also one of the streaming collection kind of a tool. But here this is our out of scope. So advanced resources like Kafka, Flume, and Twitter. So are these, all these are like advanced sources, and we need an extra packages and extra dependencies while linking these into our projects, because they ship with their own licenses, different licenses. So obviously they need a special dependencies. They don't ship with the default streaming context APIs. Okay. So these are the two types. Now, whenever you have a receiver, that means not for all types of sources, a receiver task might be running. It is for sure that for all the advanced sources, a separate receiver task will be kickstarted, and some of the basic sources like socket connections also, your Spark will run, Spark streaming will run the receiver task on the worker nodes. Now here, so for example, file systems, it may not run the receiver task. Okay? So it may run the receiver task or it may not run the receiver task based on the sources. So as example I have given, so in this, the list of sources available here. So on file systems related streaming, so it will not launch a separate receiver task on the worker nodes. Only for socket connections and advanced sources like Kafka and Twitter and all those things, it will run a separate receiver task on the worker machines. So whenever it runs a separate receiver tasks, so we have to be careful in specifying the master URLs, especially when you are running it in your local mode. If you just give your local or local of one as your master URL, that means, so local or local of one means it will allocate only one core CPU to process that, and that one core means only one thread can run, and that one thread will be used for your receiver itself, but the data will not be processed. That is anyway your local mode that will not be affecting in your real time. But coming to the real time, whenever if you are running these kind of things, if you observe how many ever the worker nodes are there in with you, let's say if there are 10 worker nodes, try to, so at least you have to allocate the executor num cores, the property that we have seen, right? Executor num cores, that number of cores that you allocate to the Spark streaming applications must be more than the number of receivers that you want to run or something, or that it will get kickstarted. Maybe in the first go itself, you may not be able to identify that. So this is all like Spark streaming, as I was telling, it's a still an incubating phase, we can say. It's still evolving. You guys have to make it a trial and error based approach. So first try allocating the 10 cores and see if that is able to process your data as fast as the data that is getting received or not. How we can identify whether my data is getting processed that speed as the data getting ingested? We can see that from the log messages. I will show you at the end of these slides. Okay. So file streams, anyway, we have seen that one example there. So last Sunday. So out of the basic sources, these are the ones, the file streams. Under file stream, the text file stream is the most famously used one. So we configure a data directory. Whenever a new files get ingested into the directory, they will get read as it is, and they will get processed and ingested onto HDFS. So this is something same as your Flume spooling directory source, correct? Isn't it? In your Flume spool directory source, if you configure a directory as an input, whenever a new files are ingested into that, so those files will get copied onto your HDFS without any processing. But here, with the help of Spark streaming, you have configured the same directory, and whenever, so it could be your local and as well as your HDFS. So here, in this case, if I give my HDFS directory, So whenever a new file is ingested into that, it will process and ingest it into wherever you want to ingest. Or if it is a local directory, it keeps monitoring into that. So since Spark has support to read all the file systems that has HDFS support, and out of which even your local file system is part of it. So it can read from your local file system and similarly act as your Flume spool directory source. And along with that, it can process, it can transform, it can do the basic transformations and then ingest the data onto your HDFS. Okay, and one good thing is that file streams do not require a running a separate receiver task. Hence, does not require allocating cores for your receivers. Otherwise, your receiver is a continuous task that will be running. So it needs a dedicated thread to be available there. And so a few points to remember about the data directory. The files must have the same data format. So if they need to be processed in the your Spark streaming, otherwise you will get casting exceptions. The files must be created in the data directory by atomically moving. That means one complete file, you have to move it there, but not like you just start opening a file there, just created an empty file and start writing into that file. That's not the case. Even this, so these are like the same dependencies or the same constraints for both Flume and here as well. Okay. So even in Flume, the same constraints. So you have to move, the files should be moved atomically. Renaming them into the data directory, completely into that. So once moved, the files must not be changed. Once the file is moved into the directory, it should not be changed. Okay. So yeah, any data appending into those files, that will not be read. So if you keep on changing. So that is the basic source and socket connection source also. I have shown you an example. Coming to the advanced sources, so you can connect to Twitter, you can connect to Kafka. So Kafka is one of the streaming source that we'll see. And so anything these advanced sources, you need an additional dependency, both for your Maven or SBT building. So in each of them, you will have its own utils classes. For example, in Twitter, you have Twitter utils. And in Flume, we have Flume utils classes. And in Kafka also, you'll find similar to this. Kafka utils, that we'll discuss anyway while discussing the Kafka tool. Okay. Now, so using these utils classes, on this utils classes, we have a create stream methods available. So this is the one that is responsible for taking the Spark streaming context object and in any additional properties, the parameters that this Twitter utils or the advanced source utils will take and returns the D streams for us. And once we have the D stream, only these two lines that will differ for basic and advanced sources. And remaining all the lines will stay common. So once you get the D stream, from there onwards, your process will continue as usual. Okay. So let me complete this basic kind of points and the stateful operations also. Then I will show you that advanced source, one of the advanced source Twitter and some of the stateful operations. We'll see that example. Okay. Now, so these are the different sources, basic and advanced sources. And coming to the receivers, again, we have two types of receivers. So one is a reliable receiver, and another one is unreliable receiver. Reliable receiver means that is the one that sends the acknowledgements to a reliable source when a data has been received and stored in Spark with replication. Okay? Once, as I have shown you in the previous slides, once the blocks are received by your receiver and replicated onto another machine, then if that receiver sends an acknowledgement back to your driver or the source, not to the driver, it should send to the source, then that is called as, those type of receivers are called as reliable receivers. If it is not going to send or not support, if it does not support the acknowledgements, then it is not called as a reliable source receivers. And for example, maybe, I mean, sometimes you may face like the file streaming sources, they are not, they don't expect a reliable receiver to be happening there. First of all, they don't have receivers at all. So automatically the worker, the streaming itself will create the streams. It doesn't need a separate receiver thread. The streaming context itself will start reading those files. Okay. And coming to the different transformations on these streams, again, the operations, these are also again two types, the stateless transformations and stateful transformations. And in stateless transformations, you assume all the RDD operations that you have seen so far, those are the examples for your stateless. And stateful, again in stateful, we have two types. So they are like window-based stateful transformations. And second one is a state by based on a state, stateful transformations, update state. Okay. So here, what is mean by stateful transformation and how is it different from stateless? Whatever the stateless transformations that you apply, so this answers some of the questions that you raised last week. Stateless transformations give you the results for that particular batch only. They does not depend on the data of its previous batches. So technically speaking, so the same methods, the same operations that you can do on RDDs. But the functionality wise, the results of these stateless transformations you will get only for a particular batch. So once you read some few lines of data in that batch, so only on that batch of, so during that batch, how many ever the vote counts that you receive, those are the ones that you have seen so far. So that is nothing but your stateless transformations. On the other hand, if you want to carry forward the state starting from the beginning, that is where you have to use update state by stateful transformations. There are two types of stateful transformations I was telling, right? So where you need the state starting from the beginning of your streaming. So once you started streaming of your data, so starting from there till the end of, till when you close your, stop your agent, until then you need the state. So that is when, where we need to keep on producing using update state by. And the second type of stateful transformation is that instead of starting with the beginning of the streaming, so you always need your aggregates for last 5 minutes or last 10 minutes or last 30 minutes. You don't want starting from the beginning, just from last 5 minutes, just from last 10 minutes. If that is the case, that is called as a window. Always that last 10 minutes or last 5 minutes is the window. So during that window, how many ever the batches that you receive, for all those batches, you will get the state. State get carried forward. And if you see some of the example operations and you will see the examples, you will get to know more and more. Okay, the definition lines may not make you completely clear, but let me show you some examples and then you will understand it. So the stateless transformations, typical your map, flat map, filter, the repartitioning. This is also one of the operations on this stream that you can divide this into number of partitions. Reduce by key, if it is a key value pair, group by key, it's a another key value pair. So these are the examples for your stateless transformations and stateless D stream transformations on two D streams. Maybe join, co group. Okay. And stateful transformations, as I was telling, there are mainly two types. So windowed operations and update state by key, which is used to track state across events for each key. Stateful transformations across events for each key. And generally the stateful transformation requires checkpointing that we'll discuss anyway in the separate slides. And these are the types or the examples for stateful transformations. So one is, the first one is the update state by key. This is the only flavor that we have. And for windowed operations, we have multiple types. So one is a window, count by window, and reduce by key and window. If it is, it is for key value pair, these streams are RDDs. This is for regular ones. And this is for count by value and window. This is again on like your key value pairs. Okay, so we'll see those examples one by one, instead of explaining here. Okay. So update state by key. So update state by key operation allows you to maintain arbitrary state while continuously updating it with new information. To use this, we'll have to do two steps. Or a simple example I can specify. So if you want to keep on counting, so you need a status that, so how many total records or how many total elements that were processed so far, that were ingested so far. So if you make that as one state, so whenever you send any list to it, I will define a function. So that function takes a list as an input and the current state. So when I'm processing the first batch, so that time my state might be 0. And when I'm processing the second batch, second window, then, so already I might have seen such kind of elements as 10. And now, if I receive 5 more in the next batch, I should increment that for that particular key, right?
Shiva, if possible, will you please explain this again?
I'm still continuing that. Okay. So let's say, so you have a streaming of data. This is one batch and this is another batch. And this is another batch. Okay. Here. So here you maintain some like set key value pairs, like some color, yellow, 5, and blue, 2, and red, 1. So this way, let's assume some string, comma, count, or its price, or some tag you're getting in the batches. Now, so your goal is to, at the end of day, at any point of time, you need the total count till that time. Not just for one batch. I'm not expecting for each batch. I need, so how many total yellows, how many total red flags or so tags or whatever it is. Okay, so in this batch I have received this many. In the next batch, I might have the value as 1, and in the subsequent batch, I might not get this. For a particular 1 second window, I might not get any yellow records. And for this, again after that, I might receive 2. Similarly, this. Here I may not get it. In this window, I might not get it. But here, I might get 1. Here, I might get it as 2. Now, at any point of time, if I take the counts, I want to do anything, here I should get as y comma 5 and b comma 2 and r comma 1. But here, in the next batch, when I run, this should become y comma 6 and b comma still 2. And let's assume r is remaining the same. R comma 1. And in the next batch, y remains same, y comma 6, and b comma, so this time b comma 3, and r remains same. Now y becomes 8 and b becomes 5. So that means your state. So here you had a state of 5. Your status or the state for your Y was 5 while crossing this batch. And when crossing the next batch, it is depending on the previous batch value. Or on the other hand, it is carry forwarding the previous batch's state to the next batch. And that state is getting carry forwarded to the next batch. That state is carry forwarded to the next batch. So this is nothing but update the state by key type of operations, where you need, so at any point of time, so what is the state starting from the beginning? So if you want to compare these examples, the better example I can give you is cricket scores. So cricket scores, when starting from the match started, so at any point of time, this is like your scorecard. So entire your scorecard, like at whatever time I ask you, you should give me the latest count, a latest score for each player. Okay? So if you just take this as, so for each player, what is the latest score at any point of time? If I ask you after 5 seconds, that particular window, what is the latest value? So you have to give me that. Next, coming to the second type of operations, those are window-based operations. So there, again in the scorecards, you might see sometimes in the messages, last five overs, runs 35, wickets two or something, and run rate, so on, so 7.0 or something. Okay, so here last five overs is the window, right? At any point of time, you will calculate these numbers only for the last 5 hours. If you are running on the 30th over, so second ball, then it considers starting from 25th over, second ball onwards, where you can take each ball as a 1 second and one window, one batch size. Every 1 second as batch, and you included 5 overs means 5 into 6, 30 seconds or 30 batches in one window. Or you might see in terms of time also sometimes, or last 10 minutes or last 30 minutes. You can say 60 runs or whatever it is, 30 runs, wicket so many, and run rate. Okay? So if you just, whenever you use last, that is last 10 minutes or last 20 minutes, last 30 minutes, that is a window-based operation. Instead that, starting from the beginning, what is the latest state? That is nothing but update state by key. Okay. So, example how to implement this update state by key is like, so update running sum, we have to build a function for this. We need to build or implement a method. So to use this, we'll have to do two steps. Define the state. The state can be an arbitrary data type. And define the state update function. Define the state update function. Specify with a function how to update the state using the previous state and the new values from an input stream. Okay, so here, if you take, this is one of the state update function, update running sum. So it takes a new collection values, sequence of long. So these are nothing but the numbers that are the values or the data that comes from your input D stream. And this is the state option of long. Equal to sum of, so I'm using sum method. So if there is a value, that will get written, otherwise none, from a particular D stream. State dot get or else of 0n. In this state, for the first D stream, there won't be any value. That time, 0L will be returned. 0L will means 0 will be returned. So from the next batch onwards, the state will be, the actual value will be returned. Now for the first D stream, so 0 plus values dot size, that will be returned here. And for the next the same state will be carry forwarded. When it's processing the next batch stream, then that value will be get here, and the next value, that stream's size will get added to that. So that way it keeps on getting added for every batch. And once you have the state update running some method that you have to use in this update state by key method. So let's say val response codes dstream. So response code dstream access logs dstream.map for every log, log.get response code. Get the response code and maintain its count as 1, and response code count to dstream. Response code dstream dot update state by key. So provide your method. And all the values for all the similar kind of keys, it collects the all the values and sums them up and it returns them. That means at any point of time, how many status 200 codes received, how many 404s received, how many 505 pages received, page not found, or 404, server not running. Okay. That is one example. And the next one is, if you take just very simple one, let's say I have a tweet messages, and in my Twitter, at different times, I can set my different mode status, right? So I can set feeling exciting, feeling boring, feeling sleepy. I can set different statuses in my Twitter. So in my tweets, I can set my status. So those status can be changing at different times. That means that always keeps on updating. And in these cases, it doesn't make sense to take any averages or these things for last 10 minutes or last 5 minutes kind of. You always need the latest updated mood or status, right? So let's say in T minus one, he's having a different mode, and T is having different mode, and this time is. So always you have to give the latest mode. Okay. Next, let me take these two examples also, and then I will show you the example with Twitter program, and I will run that. Now, so the window operations. So window operation is nothing but the same as I was telling you. So if you consider this a few batches into your window, so here again, you will have two parameters, two time parameters that we specify. One for batch size. Batch size might be 1 second or 5 seconds or 10 seconds. Anything can be your batch size. And what is your window size? So with that, you'll specify window of your window size and comma batch size. For example, if you see here on your dstream, so access logs dstream dot window of seconds of 30 means every 30 seconds. So for last 30 seconds, so what is happening? So seconds of 30 seconds is the window, but your batch size itself is 10 seconds. That means every window you will see 3 batches. Now, any counts that you prepare against this window, windowed dstream, that means you will get all those values for last 3 batches, the status for last 3 batches. And all windowed operations need 2 parameters, window duration and sliding window duration, both of which must be a multiple of streaming context patch interval. Multiples of, so most of the times we maintain this, the second parameter equal to the batch size, batch interval. Or in the worst case, the integral multiples of your batch interval. If your batch interval is 0.3 seconds, so you can't maintain seconds sliding interval as 1 second or something like that. Just it needs to be always integral multiples of that. Okay? And as a standard or I mean, there is not much standards also I can specify to you. As I am telling, this is more of like a still in evolving phase and incubating phase. So you might be using this Spark streaming mostly for your basic kind of POCs, not even for complete real time, unless until you get any enterprise supports for these things. Okay. Even if you do anything production, that may not be that business critical. Okay. Now, yeah, just as an example, Twitter stream, I got the D stream and I applied some flat map and again I got another D stream. On that, I'm applying my window operations, like window of minutes of one and seconds of one. Means 1 minute is my window and 1 second is my batch or sliding window interval. So count by value, that means the values count will be given to you always for the last 1 minute. So if you imagine this, so this is how your data gets streaming. Okay, so data gets streaming continuously. So at any point of time you take your data. So let's say this is your last 1 minute. And you have this many batches in this 1 minute window. And you will get your tag counts for this minute. Next, if the time changes, that's the window length and sliding interval. If the time, so let's say if the sliding interval is double the batch size, your batch size is 1/2 second, where when you create your streaming context, so you have specified as a batch interval as just 1/2 second, then every slide you will include 2 batches. Okay. So next, this is the next. If you slide two batches to the left side, so for the next calculations, this will become your the next window. And that gives you the latest count. And again, after another 1 second, so these 2 batches will be excluded. And here, 2 more batches will be included into the computation. That way, your window will get slided towards the new data. Okay. At any point of time, let's if you take a different seconds, you have this hashtags, the same hashtag. So if you are sliding window, so and so, if you consider this is your window, and you got your so and so count overall the data in that window. For the next second, 1 second pass, your window will get moved. And you will get total count by using these batches. Okay. So those are the stateful transformations. Both the update state by key and window operations. And the last one that you can do on your D-streams is output operations. Either you specify to save them as text file or print them anyway we have seen so far. So printing them we have seen already. Save as text files or save as Hadoop files. This is the ones that we see. Object files, we don't use them because they are like, okay. Object files is nothing but saving them as a sequence files. Okay. So here the prefix, what is the prefix for each one of those files and the what is the suffix, and it uses the timestamp in between them and stores them into that path. You can see that example now. Okay. Now the so before checking that I might be using the RDD checkpointing also there. So we talked about this already in while we were discussing the RDDs. Again, to reiterate it in this concept, especially in stateful transformations. In stateful transformations, if you take each batch as one RDD, so every RDD is dependent on the previous RDD, correct? So that means if you have 100 batches in a particular window, even if you take windowed operations, so in that particular window, all the batches are dependent on the previous set of batches. So let's say if you are at 100th batch, 100th batch is dependent on 99th batch, and 99th batch is dependent on 98th, and 98th batch is dependent on. That way, starting from first batch to 100th batch, they are depending on in sequence, one on the other, if it is a window operation. If it is update state by key, starting from the beginning, all the RDDs are depending on the previous batch. That means at any point of time, if any of this RDDs data is lost, that means to calculate that, it has to start from the beginning. If you are performing any action of the RDD status, it has to start performing the actions from beginning. So instead of doing that, for recomputing that, so in order to start from, as I was telling you, right, whenever you, if you perform an action, then only the data will be coming into that RDD. So if that RDD itself is lost, in order to recompute that, whenever you run an action, that will start from the beginning. So it has to start from the beginning. So let's say if you have these many, so you have, this is your latest, or this is how, from starting from here, you are building your RDDs this way. So if you store this somewhere on your disk, RDD.checkpoint, so this, instead of performing all these things, you have stored the contents of RDD, the red RDD, saved into HDFS file. So from next time onwards, even if you lost this, so you can read your data from here. That's the point of maintaining your checkpoint. Okay. Stateful D-stream operators can have infinite lineages. So large lineages lead to large closure of the RDD object, large task sizes, high task launch times, high recovery times under failures. That's the reason. So at regular intervals, it's always better to checkpoint them. So periodic RDD checkpointing solves this. You don't need to checkpoint every RDD. So periodic checkpointing will solve that purpose. Okay. And RDD checkpointing needs to be determined again like a trial and error basis. You should start with, you should not checkpoint too frequent, which will make your process go slow down, because of HDFS writing will slow things down. So checkpointing too infrequent again, so there is a risk that task launch times, like all of a sudden after all the so many task lineages happen, once you run an action, it has to start computation from the beginning. So then it will be taking a lot of time. Okay. So default settings checkpointing is at most like once in 10 seconds. So this is the default setting that is recommended to start with. Try to checkpoint once in about every 10 seconds. To checkpoint, as we have seen in the Spark shells, the same way, we have to specify the checkpoint directory for that Spark streaming. And whenever you checkpoint an RDD or dstring, that will get written onto the listing. And this is persisting your dstreams or catching your dstreams can also be done. So the same RDD catching that we have seen, the same stuff, nothing different. Okay. Only the difference is that difference from RDD's default level, where in RDDs, whenever you persist an RDD, so that was getting persisted only in memory. Memory only. The default storage level was memory only, but here memory only underscore serializer. Okay, which means it will get stored in the memory, but in a serialized form, because these D streams needs to be copied onto one machine to another machine. So where you need the data to be serialized. Okay, performance tuning we can discuss. So let me show you this one Twitter advanced source example, the help of all those stuff. So I have commented out unnecessary code here. So all the necessary classes imported. So created the Spark conf object val conf new Spark conf. Set application name. Okay. And set the master to have at least two threads. Okay. I can't give more than that because I have allocated only two ports to my quick start VM. Okay. So set local of two. So one thread for receiver and one for processing. Okay. So created the Spark context object and creating the streaming context object. By passing the Spark context and my batch size is 10 seconds. So every 10 seconds is treated as one batch. Now, all I need to do is I just need to pass this SSC to my Twitter utils to create my Twitter stream. See, as I was showing you on the slide, Twitter utils dot create stream and pass your Spark streaming context SSC. And any additional parameters, if it is going to expect this Twitter utils, and the filters, the authentication filters. So in order to connect with your Twitter, it is not just with your Spark streaming or not just with your Kafka or something. Even in Flume or however you want to connect to your Twitter APIs, you need to get authenticated. So for that, you need a Twitter developer account to be available. So where you need the consumer key and consumer secret, access token and access token secret. Once you set up your Twitter developer account, there you can see these tokens. So one, you can get those tokens. You have to use them, otherwise you will not be able to connect to your Twitter API. So once you connect to your Twitter, you can get, so I'm taking here those four tokens from the command line arguments, and those take write from this args array, taking the write last four, args.length minus four, the last four elements, and setting those properties to Twitter forge OAuthorization, OAuth consumer key, OAuth consumer secret, and setting this property to this Twitter forge, and using that, the filters, passing this filter array to here. So if I set this create Twitter utils dot create stream, so that's it. I got my this string. Input this string. This is my input this string. On this, what I'm trying to do is every status or the every tweet that I receive, so I'm getting the text out of it. Dot get a text flat map, converting that to get text of that, and dot split by space, so you'll get more values. Now once you split that, so filtering them to extract only that starts with hash, because in tweet messages we specify our status using the hashtags, right? So I'm filtering only those texts, only those strings that start with hash. Out of all the strings, I'm filtering out only my hashtags. That is where, how I can get my hashtags. So for the sake of testing, I'm just printing them here. And then once I print them, I can do a count by value, which will give, this is not a window D string. This is just a regular D string. On that count by value, I can print there. But on this hashtags, so map every underscore comma one. So I'm mapping every hashtag comma one, then reduce by key and window. I'm applying. That means for a particular window of reduce by key and window, your window duration is seconds of 60. Means for last 1 minute, what are the counts? These are your regular counts for separate, which are separate for each batch. But these are the accumulated counts for last 6 batches. If you have 10 seconds as the batch window. So 10 seconds only, right? Specified there. Yes. So this is for last 6 batches. And for every those topic comma count, I'm reversing them, count comma topic. This is just for my doing some reverse of that. That transform dot sort by key to have them, because I'm making key value to value comma key, or this way I interchange the key value pairs, and then sort by key as false, and accept the counts comma topics. We can see them now. The top counts. The tag counts, which are nothing but your tag counts dot print already printing there, right? So tag counts for last 60 seconds. So here, top counts 60. Top count 60 dot print. Okay. And inside again, top count 60 dot, this is a D stream. Again, you can see that for each RDD, so for each batch, that means for every, each batch means every 10 seconds. So in that each RDD, so while top list RDD dot take of 10. In each RDD, I'm taking the first top 10 and printing them. So popular topics in last 60 seconds, RDD.count and top list dot for each case of count comma tag, println, these things. This means, so you're printing what are the popular topics in last 60 seconds. And then again, for the last using the for each RDD, so you are printing for the last 10 seconds RDD from each RDD, which means from each batch, take the 10 last to 10 or the top 10 and print them there. Okay, I think I might be having a point also in April somewhere. So first I need to build it. Test, apply and run. Yeah, it will take some time. Just give me a minute break. Yeah, it's still building. Oh, okay. Got success. So just if I check this, so I can show you those access tokens as well. Somewhere, the Scala applications, Twitter stream. Test might be simple streaming test and the arguments. So these are my access tokens that I have used. These tokens, you will get it from the Twitter developer account. Okay, most of you guys might be having an idea already. I just run this. Still launching Twitter stream test. Yeah, it's launching. So I can lock my screen. Can see some messages here. Popular topics were not there in that window. Yep. You can see some of them. So if I'm printing them, you can observe. Yeah, so those are the some of the popular topics in the last 60 seconds. 379 total are there, and you can see them, those messages also. So what were the messages and what were the topics? I will stop it now. Okay. You can see. So when it was printing the first stuff, like the first print when we used, it's more of like a debugging hashtags. It first collected all the hashtags. Has 2 days left for push award starting. Has your hashtags for on iPhone as well. Has iPhone 7 iApp free. Okay. Has keep pounding all these things. So these are your hashtags. So first, you received your hashtags, and then, so after that, let's see that, well, in the next batch window, they will get processed here. So you can see then the next one is a hash count counts, right? Where your hashtags comma, your counts, tag counts dot print, tag counts. By each count by value for that particular batch, this is the count by value where I mapped it with comma one, count by value. Okay, so one is hashtags printing by comma count printing. So just by comma count printing, and then next you can see them. Top 60, then I reverse them, count comma topic, right? I reverse them, count comma topic, and sort by key, set this here. Descending order to specify false, but here sort by key. Ascending order as false, that means it might be descending. So you can see 19, perfect illusion midnight, 2 days left for push awards, 17 tags are there with this, 17 are there with this hashtag, and perfect illusion, 11 are there, push awards, L amazing, and vote Claudian, all these things. So these are the counts. So those things are there for them. A reverse order I printed. Then again in the popular topics, when we see here, popular topics in the last 60 seconds, it can give you the count, the total count. And then from each top list for every RDD, what are the top 10? So popular topics in last 60 seconds are 515. And out of in each RDD, RDD.takeoff, count comma tag, count comma tag. So top list dot for each case of count comma tag, print ln of this tag comma count. So it's giving you finally the two top ones are like, so the perfect illusion midnight and 2 days left for push awards. So this way you, for last 60 seconds, so the top most performing ones, you can get them. And these ones are also like, this is 17, 2 days left for push awards. This is 17 tweets, and perfect illusion, 11 tweets, and push awards, amazing, for the top 10. Okay. So these are the top 10 hashtags and their counts. So that way, for every batch, you will get separate keywords, and for every window you see what is the last 60 seconds, the most popular hashtags or statuses that people are talking about, you can get them, and you can even store them into your files. I have some example for them also, if I'm not wrong. Maybe save as text files or save as Hadoop files. I have examples. Let me see. Streaming word count, streaming log input, So this entire project, anyway, I have shared with you this project examples. Okay, there is nothing in this. The Spark project examples and both the Spark streaming test examples also. Okay. Streaming test might be the one. Okay, this is also not the one. Hey, myself kidding, confused. Maybe I will try to share you a checkpoint example also. I was doing that actually. I was having the same Spark streaming example. Maybe for Kafka, I think Kafka Spark. Holdcon from HDFS location Twitter streaming example. Not in this one also. Okay, so might be write data to HDFS. Streaming context, I commented this out. Even this much is not needed. This is also not the one.
Shiva, like the projects are not shared because I tried to copy those Maven things. So I think it is not shared. I'm not sure where it is.
Code examples. Examples.
Okay.
Not there. If it is not there, I'll put the project.
It's not there, Shiva. On the
drive. Even only we have 18 days of like zipper thing. I don't think so. We have the last class code was up. Video was updated.
Okay. Then I will push there today. Okay. Okay?
Thank you.
These two projects. So Spark project examples and Spark streaming. Both of them, I will push it into your Spark. Only 18, you can see them. Okay, let me take. So the 19th one is not there. Okay, no problem. I will upload it today. Okay, both the 19th and 20th one.
Shiva, please share that case class example as well.
Case class.
Excel sheet that is not coming up.
Okay. Let me put that right away. Otherwise, even I will forget. So, how to write a custom case classes, right?
Yes.
So, Excel sheet is nothing to deal with. That's a just a data, 30 columns. Okay.
Do you have how to merge those files and read as one? Do you have any example?
How to read merge?
Multiple small files and read.
Yes, we'll. It's just a matter of reading that directory. That's it, right? I mean, we have seen that example, right?
Whole. What is it?
Project.
Yeah.
Yeah, whole project code. I might not be. I mean, just example. Just make them frames. That's it.
And we do the same thing for XML file and all. Can we do the same thing?
Yeah, that we used for XML files only. That example. Okay. So I will push this. Okay, next. So maybe the RDD checkpointing, I will show it with the help of your Kafka example when we're running. Kafka and Spark. Yep. So I will show you that and the checkpointing also. I can show you how I created them there. Okay. So let's not worry about that right now then.
Shiva, one more quick question because it's related to the previous class.
Yes, Kalpana.
It's Mamata here.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
In case like when we, you know, like we can run the SQL statements too, how do I know what are the functions which are supported in the SQL statement when we are doing that? Because I don't see anywhere, even in the Spark document, I don't know what all the SQL functions are supported.
I gave you just a summary in Spark SQL that what all features are supported from your Hive, but what not. Okay? This compatibility with Hive. So maybe you might have missed this slide.
I don't see this there are so many string functions are there, right? Those are all not there.
I mean, keep exploring them. How does that matter to you?
Yeah, because I tried, many of the commands did not work. That's the reason I am asking.
It didn't work? All of them?
Not all. All did not work.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, so as I was telling you, right, these things, Spark SQL and Spark Streaming, mm-hmm. even the Cloudera and Hortonworks guys are not yet ready to provide you the enterprise support. These are just evolving. You just have to keep exploring them. You're already ahead of the market, and you have to keep exploring. You may not find that sophisticated documents and spoon-feeding guidelines anywhere.
No, I'm not talking about the documents.
High level, the direction you will find, like, so it supports most of the Hive operators and UDFs and UDAs, and it says partitioning views and all those things. Means you start using them in Spark SQL and you explore till how much level they are supported and till how much level they are not. when I say Hive and Impala compatibility also, I say lot many things. But some of the functions, if I go, if you take one example, string split is available in Hive. It's not available in Impala. I don't need to highlight that level when I'm comparing those things. Sometimes I might explain you that if that strikes in my mind, but that doesn't strike, that's not a big deal, right?
No, Shiva, I'm not talking about you because, you know, this UDF joins are the bigger pictures, okay? Okay, you join those tables, mm-hmm. but when you select those tables, what we do in especially SQLs, we have so many date functions, string functions, and mathematical functions.
String functions will anyway will work. I know for sure, concatenate, substring, these things I have seen, those are working. But date functions won't be.
I said, I think left, right, and many things I tried, it did not work. So I just wanted to know that is there any, because even I searched these Spark documents, like where, is there a way where we can see what all the functions are supported? I don't see that. That's the reason.
You will not find that. That's what I'm telling you. You'll not find that much sophisticated guides for you. Only thing is, you have to keep exploring when you are working on something, emerging technology. So we only have to start doing the documentation. That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Okay. So most of the
I might not be able to give you that complete list.
No. I am not asking you. Okay. So okay. I was just finding, is there a way for us to know? You know, there are many functions. That's the reason I ask you, because I'm very much familiar with SQL, right? So every day I use it. So
yeah, even on high level, this is the list that I was able to find.
Okay.
So I prepared this. That's it.
Because I tried many commands, it didn't work. So I was.
The basic ones didn't work. Concat, substring. And
substring worked. Concat, I didn't try. I tried left, right, and tried couple of functions. I don't remember what all I functioned. Maybe around 20 to 30 functions I tried.
Upper, and lower, these things are not working. Lowercase, uppercase, first, LC.
I think even I tried upper, lower, it was not working, but in the examples it was given. So that's where I was a bit confused.
Okay. Maybe, I mean, even if that is not working, one simple straightaway answer for your real-time scenarios, if you have, so just implement that in Scala as a function and register it as a UDF. That's the simplest, very simple way to write your UDFs in Spark SQL. Right?
Okay.
It's not so complex, right? Unlike your Hive UDFs where you need to write in Java, build a jar and register and then create a temporary function, all that stuff. Just define a function and use that register as a temp table. And even if you might have seen in my...
I was thinking I might have to import some DLLs. This was, not DLLs, some jars.
Yeah, some jars might be. Some packages you are talking about, right?
Yeah, packages. That's what I was thinking. So I thought maybe I'm doing wrong somewhere. That's what I was
thinking. Then why don't you try with importing all the SQL dot underscore you can use this SQL struct type packages, all these packages. Did you include all these?
No, because I was under assumption that, as I said, right, I might be wrong somewhere because I was under assumption, right? If I work in Scala, I need not import all this. This was my assumption.
No. If you work in Java, you will not get all the packages.
Sorry, same not Java. In the Scala.
No, coming. If you work in Scala, the same way, you will not get all the packages. When I was telling you the packages in Scala, native Scala, when we were discussing, I was telling you that java.lang is the default package and scala.arg or something, that's the default packages that you will get. Any
default package
that you obviously have to import them.
Shell, Shiva?
So java.lang is the default package scala.arg or something.
No, I'm not talking about the Scala. In the
shell. Spark shell. Even in Spark shell.
Okay.
So
yeah. Yeah. Probably like this time I will try.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah.
So, yeah. So we have seen a couple of the transformations, the window-based operations as well. So the last 60 minutes and stuff. And checkpointing example, I will directly show you with the Kafka example itself. Yep. Let me close these slides. Okay. So next, let me explain you what are the things that we need to keep in mind when we are performance tuning. How do you decide whether your Spark job is speed enough or sufficient enough to process the incoming data at which it is getting generated? Okay, so there is achieving a stable configuration. So there is a log messages that you will always see in your logs. The total delay. So if you observe our log messages also here, so the total delay will be, there will be one log message that will be coming for every batch. So total delay, the job scheduler. So total delay in processing the current batch is 3.197 seconds for time for this window, for this batch that started at this particular timestamp, to process that, it was the delay time. Okay, and next, similarly, if you find the next search, unfortunately, I have only one. Okay, I have only one then in this. For every batch, it should print as that. Of course, it prints as that. So while it is continuously running, then we might see that. So what I'm trying to say is, from one batch to another batch, it keeps on printing that delay time. This is the only one that we have. So from batch to batch, it keeps on printing this. If it always getting increased, so for one batch, it is 3.19 seconds. And for the next batch, if it prints 4 seconds, for the next batch, if it prints 5 seconds, for the next batch, if it prints 6 seconds. So if the total delay is continuously increasing, then unstable as the system is unable to process data as fast as it's receiving. So from batch to batch, the delay time is getting increased means the previous batch was not processed on time and it was taking more than expected. And the current batch is again getting increased. That means, so you're not processing at the speed of your data receiving. Your processing is taking more time than the data incoming speed. So if that is the case, then we obviously have to increase some cores so that it can execute on multiple executors. So executor num cores, you can increase them. The total delay stays roughly constant. Instead of increasing, if it stays roughly constant and around the 2 times of the configured batch duration. Let's say if I specified my batch duration as 10 seconds, if it is less than or equal to the 2 times of your batch duration, so this is okay then. So it is able to process on time. It's a stable configuration. Okay. So how to configure, how to figure out a good stable configuration? Start with a low data rate, as small as possible, small number of nodes, reasonably large batch duration, a small low data rate. So push your low with the less speed, large batch duration as 5 to 10 seconds, and increase the data rate slowly, and then observe your system is able to process that speed or not, and find the bottleneck in the job processing as well. While processing the job, so you can see the job stages and find out which stage is exactly taking more time, and then see if we can do any optimization at the stage level. Okay, so this much of things nobody will ask you in your interviews also, but maybe your real-time projects, maybe after 6 months or 1 year, if your enterprise is going to do all this stuff, that time you may refer these things back. At this moment, mostly you, even if you have to use these things, mostly it will be a kind of POCs. Nobody will start directing the projects real-time project. Okay. And for example, like on which stage is taking a longer time, if you find that, like if the first map stage on raw data is taking most time, then try enabling delayed scheduling by setting property spark.locality.weight equal to true. Splitting your data source into multiple substrings, meaning multiple partitions. Repartitioning the raw data into many partitions as first step. Because the first map stage itself is taking long time means it is not having enough of the tasks to read that RDD. If that is not having enough RDDs, enough tasks to read that RDD, you divide that into more partitions so that you will get more tasks. Then that map task can be increased speed. If any of the subsequent stages are taking a lot of time, try increasing the level of parallelism. Obviously, the partitions, repartitioning them, increasing the more tasks, and for each reducer, keep increasing the driver memory and the executor memories, and the number of cores, keep increasing them on the nodes. And then maybe you make the speed of your input data. Okay, and few more optimizations that you can think of is like, try to enable this serializer, Spark serializer as a cryo serializer, as we were talking about. So this is one of the configuration property that you can set at your Spark conf object. Okay, set property spark.serializer as spark cryo serializer, spark closer serializer as, even for closers. Okay, we have Scala closers that we have seen, right? So any data that gets distributed in the closers, so inside a map, if you have any closer that is getting executed on multiple worker nodes, that time also serializer will come into picture, because the data gets transferred from your worker nodes to your driver pack, right? You can specify these two properties to enable the cryo serialization than the default serialization for both data and tasks. Okay. So when you are persisting your RDDs or D streams, that time try to disable the serialization, because serialization, if you enable them, while persisting, while reading it back, it takes relatively longer time. Without serialization, if you just use memory only, that will be faster than memory only serializer. So these are some of the hints that you guys have to keep in mind. So something like start increasing the driver memories, executor memories, and cores, and repartitioning them whenever is needed based on the which stage is taking longer times, and keep persisting them if needed, wherever is needed. And when you are persisting them, try to avoid the serialization, and in overall serialization of your application, where your RDDs partitions will get transferred or results will get transferred across the network, that time try to enable your cryo serializations instead of your Java serialization. These are some of the optimization techniques of the guidelines that you guys can keep in mind. And further guidelines, performance tuning, you may refer this path tuning guide, tuning.html. And Spark streaming tuning guides. So this example, Twitter example, we have seen. Okay? Then I will get started with the advanced source, one of the advanced source for this, which is the most popular and the best combination or the popular combination with Spark streaming. So most of the times you will see the Kafka. Even if you are reading from files or directories, so we use Kafka to configure and most of the times. Okay?
So Shiva, quick question.
Yep. Before going to that, we can discuss any quick questions if you have.
Okay. Yeah. So in general, what is the downside and what is the upside of having a batch size? I mean, having a large batch size or a small batch size?
So small batch size means as and when you receive one second data that is treated as one separate RDD, that will be processed quickly. So even so, small batch sizes will get processed quickly. Large batch size means large RDD, right?
Right.
So large RDD means it may not, if it is not getting partitioned efficiently, then you may be in a trouble that, so not many tasks are getting kicked off on that RDD, processing might take longer time.
Okay. What is the downside of having like too small of batch?
Too small, yeah. If you maintain too small batch sizes, so what will happen is for every small batch, an RDD and separate tasks will be running. So let's say if that one second batch is not producing more than 10 MB, that might not be a good batch size then. Because for every 10 MB, you're running separate tasks. So there will be too many tasks creation and maintenance of those tasks and keeping those tasks.
Okay. But those, okay. Anyway.
Yeah. Shiva?
Yes.
And like after all this, is there a possibility wherein you can, share one of the project, like these are the code we write, but apart from that, in the real-time
project
scenario?
Code, I might not be able to share, Mamta, but I can.
No, I'm not asking you to share.
Okay.
Yes, sure. Like how do we log? I mean, where do we use log and exception, try catch block, those things in the real time? How do
same
we
use like them? Your Java, nothing different, the same logger, log4j, so you can use. I mean, right. This is not pure, even I can confidently say that I didn't work a pure end-to-end only Spark only project. Okay, you will not find anywhere you will use only Spark on Spark SQL. You should not be expecting that kind of project. You will not find also.
Yeah, it is a part of scalar, okay. Right? Like
the mix of like
many functions were not available. In that case, you have to write scalar functions.
No. Let me complete what I'm trying to say. Here, so what is like, so in any typical Hadoop project, you will find it like you need your data to be ingested onto Hadoop, right? There you might end up in either using Scoop or Flume or Kafka.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Once you get your data into it, for all the scenarios, you might not use Spark always, okay? So some places, maybe for transformations, you will use Spark, and while storing into your, maybe if you need updates, you store into HBase. Otherwise, either onto Hive or Impala. Okay. And again, here, when you are running your reports for a 3 months or 4 months or 1 month period, obviously you should not use Spark because it needs a lot of memory. You will be consuming all the RAM memory of your cluster. So any batch kind of stuff, you still need to use your Hive and Impala or even MapReduce sometimes. When it's really huge data, batch, even if you wait for 1 day, if it is not a problem, you can do it that way. And so you'll see a mix of all these tools into a real-time project.
Okay.
So here, most of the stuff, if you are writing in of course, in Java, so the same kind of Java logarithm, log4j properties, same log4j logger, the same logger classes that we use, right? Sometimes, if I get time, I will pull one or two source programs and I will show you how we use the, and the same try-catch blocks that we have seen in Scala, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that stuff you can put in try-catch blocks. Scala try-catch blocks examples we have seen.
Yeah, it's only in Scala. We don't have anything like that in Spark, right?
Whatever you are writing in Scala only, right? Yeah, everything is in Scala.
Sorry. Spark shell, whatever we are doing it, that is... Okay.
Also, it's a Scala shell only. All commands are Scala only. It's just an API.
Okay. Okay. Got it.
Because
yep. I tried whatever example is through only shell. I didn't write the application and try. You know.
See, so let's say if you have this reading a text file. I have this. Okay. Mm-hmm. I obviously have to put this now in a try catch block.
Yeah, because that file may not be available.
Available. Then you can put your cast as file not found exception. That's it.
Okay. And throwing, and you know, sometimes we throw
same syntax I have shown you, right? Yeah, same syntax as I have shown you in Scala. At throws, you can specify at any over above any method so that it can throws that such kind of exceptions at any point of time.
Okay.
The same way exceptions in Scala that we talked at the end of it.
Yeah. Again, I have to go through to make proper thing. So I will go through. But I just wanted to because I always practicing my commands in the shell. So I never.
No problem. That is the best, the first start to do with actually. Even when we are doing real time development, we first execute things in shell if it is giving proper results or at least to the closer. Then we start putting that into the project and build the project and then run it from the terminals. That's how we do it in real time.
Same printf commands we can give for debugging and everything.
So this is almost like first we debug in the shell and then we do it in the application.
Okay. Because I'm not very much familiar in using those, Maven or this Eclipse. So that's where I was bit. I am from a different background, so that's the reason I was asking.
Yep, no problem. That's how actually we, even in general, we follow it like.
Okay.
Because that's the quickest thing to, so that you can start with testing your code is working or not, right?
Yeah, because when I try in Scala, it takes such a long time. So when I write it in shell, it is very faster.
Yep.
Shiva, I'm not sure. I didn't. I might have missed one or two videos to watch for me. Like, have you seen any examples like storing the data into HBase? I don't remember. Like,
I will show you in Kafka.
Okay.
I will show you with the help of a real time use case. Real time use case. One of the use case where we use Kafka and store the results into HBase.
Okay, and connecting the other databases, it depends on version to version what we are Spark using, or it's a different, the same. Let's say I want to connect to SQL. Let's say
same,
I want
almost
to
same, I can say.
Okay, it doesn't.
JDBC string that I have given you, right? Some Spark SQL, JDBC connection string, and we connected to one of the MySQL, but it was giving a different error, like a driver was not found kind of stuff, right? Same. So this was the example that I gave you to connect to MySQL. And similarly, here instead of MySQL, if you want to give, the connection string will differ, that's it.
Okay, okay.
The driver name, those things, it will differ, that's it.
Okay, so if it is SQL, different server. If it is Oracle, it's a different JDBC string.
JDBC connection string, yeah.
Okay, okay, got it. Thank you, Shiva.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so if we can spend at least half an hour or 35 minutes, I will give you the overview of Kafka, and I will finish off Kafka tomorrow. And day after tomorrow, we can discuss more on to one end-to-end project, where we use and why we use, and that you can exactly use it or explain it in your interviews for your resume preparation, and to ask anything related to the real time on that. Okay, that will be more of like your guidance on the interview preparation and resume preparation and project explanation. Okay, let me start with this. Okay. So, to get started with Kafka. So, this is one another open source Apache project. First, initially, it got developed at LinkedIn, but later got contributed to ASF. Okay. Apache Software Foundation. So, and made it as an open source tool. So what it means actually, so Kafka is one of the message broker system, works on a publish and subscribe mechanism. So what it means, we'll discuss in the next slides. Message brokering means keeps on receiving, listening for new messages that are coming in on its way and sending them to the target. So all it can is like, it's a postman job kind of stuff, where receive same like your, similar to your Plume kind of stuff, but we'll see what is the difference between those and here. And it's designed for processing of real-time activity, mostly the streaming of data. And if anything that on the way that the messages are getting generated. Okay. And it's written in Scala. And some of the features are like persistent messaging, meaning the messages will be persistent in the broker that we'll see. So high throughput supports both queue and topic semantics. We'll discuss this. Uses Zookeeper for forming a cluster of nodes, and it has a multi-language support for publish and consumer API. And one new evolution that is coming on, maybe if you guys are already having an idea of Flume, so Flume plus Kafka can also be integrated, and that is some new tool that is coming on from Cloudera, that is Flafka. Okay. Which is anyway, that is out of our scope, that is still incubating phase. Of course, even this is also like that only, not heavily used in real time. But we can start thinking of integrating these things and explaining use cases to your business people so that can slowly implementing them. Okay. Maybe once after you complete this Kafka topic, if any one of you guys interested, you can explore Flafka as well. Flume plus Kafka. Okay, that is one another tool that is coming up on next week. Now, so what is the difference between your Flume and your Kafka? So other log aggregation only systems like Scribe and Flume are architected for push to drive the data. That means if you have an idea on Flume, so in Flume you will have source and channel and sync, right? Source will push the data into channel and channel will push the data into sync. It's a push based mechanism. It pushes the data to this and it pushes the data to sync. That's a push based mechanism. So high performance and scale, however, expected endpoints are large. Example Hadoop. Endpoints cannot have lots of business logic in real time because they have to consume as fast as data is pushed to them. Accepting the data is their main job. And this is where your architectural decision comes into picture when deciding to which one to go with. So when you really, you're getting your files with source fast and you're not worried about processing, you just want to push them onto Hadoop as fast as they are getting received. That time, the best one to choose is Flume. Because you don't have to process anything. As and when the data arrives at your source, the data will get pushed onto your target. And as it is telling, endpoints cannot have lots of business logic. So however you receive your input data, exactly that you will push into your target Hadoop. And generally this Flume and these things cannot be integrated with your processing engines. Any of your endpoint cannot be a processing engine. It would be a processing engine. It would not be a processing engine. It would be always a file system, either a local file system or HDFS or HBase. Okay. And how is it different from, so these systems are purely intended for the large files transfers into HDFS. And there are the other scenarios like where you'll find the small messaging queues, messaging systems like RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, and TIBCO Message Broker. Maybe those are something like enterprise ones. The problem with those things is that they does not scale well. And they do not have API for batching and transactional. They can only send up to some messages, but not beyond some certain amount of messages. Our Kafka lies in between them. When you need the speed and scalability and also a certain amount of processing, you want to, your endpoint needs to be integrated with some processing engine like Spark and do on-the-fly processing and then push the data onto your HDFS. So that's when you have to go with your Kafka. Okay?
Why we really need on-the-fly processing?
On-the-fly processing. So sometimes, like if you are generating your log messages on a particular port, just a typical example, okay? Let me take typical, very typical one. So you are not bothered about all the debug messages to store on your target, okay? Maybe you are just interested in just the warning messages and error messages. You are not even interested in your info messages or debug messages. You can filter them out on the fly. And you can store, by the time they get stored there, whenever that comes on, you can see the stats like, okay, you received 100 warnings today and 10 error messages. And what are those error messages? And what are the, for last 1 hour, what are the error messages? And what are the info messages that I received? So if you don't do the on the fly processing, so everything comes to its own benefits, right? So on the fly processing, as and when the data is pushed, so within a near real-time batch processing, we call this, right? As and when the data is getting produced from your server, if you are able to see statistics on the fly, so within a few seconds, that means your business users will get impressed a lot. Instead of waiting for hour, if you ask your business user to wait for 1 day, then tomorrow I will provide you discounts. Then does he really interested in that? Because tomorrow he will get a new set of infos and warning messages. And he will not be in a position to act on them sometimes. Time is precious there. Some responses need a timely action. Some use cases may wait for batch, always. Wherever you need a real-time response or real-time decision to be taken, then the on-the-fly processing comes into picture. That is what your Spark streaming is intended for, on-the-fly processing. So this is the one, like your Kafka is one of the advanced source that can push your data to Spark Streaming. The basic sources that we have seen in Spark Streaming, only files, reading from a files or directory, either it could be local or HDFS, same like your Flume spooling source, spooling directory source, or listening on a socket ports, those two. And we have seen that Twitter also, and similarly, the Twitter is also again like an advanced source that we have seen. And similarly, Kafka, using Kafka, again, you can do its with its different kinds of sources. It can listen on different kinds of sources and integrate with this Spark streaming and start processing them. Okay? And should I use Kafka for really large file transfers? Now tell me, if you really have very large files in the sense, 100 GBs of files, 200 GBs of files. So that time, obviously the answer is no. For those scenarios, the recommended tool is to go with your Flume. It's designed for messages, not really for large files. If you need to ship large files, consider good file transfer or breaking up the files and reading per line to move to Kafka or alternative. Okay, if you still want to process them through Kafka, so break those files, break up them by day wise or hourly wise, and then read each small file per line. Small file in the sense, you should not expect it as like 1 MB, 10 MB something. It can still process out 100 MB files or so around that. Is it as a replacement for Rabbit MQ or messaging queues like TIBCO messaging queue? Probably yes. The performance numbers are drastically superior. Also, your Kafka's performance numbers, okay? Also gives the ability for transient consumers, handles failures pretty well. So if security on the broker and across the wire is important, obviously not yet. Because, so this is one area where all of your Hadoop related tools are lacking in. You can't really enforce much security in any of Hadoop related things. You have to follow a very long and workarounds. But of course, in Kafka, we don't have much security enabled yet. Okay. So to do transformations of data, not really by Kafka itself, but the end point of Kafka is obviously the Spark streaming that can do all the transformations. This is to just the pass your information from source to target. Okay. And before going into the actual software Kafka, let's try to understand the two types of messaging systems. So one is a queue-based messaging system, and second one is a topic-based messaging system. And queue-based messaging system means where a sender will be sending messages and they will be stored in a queue, one after the other. And based on the receiver, whoever is the receiver, that will be sent to that particular receiver. If it sees the two addresses, this receiver, and then for the next queue, for the next message in the queue, if it finds a different receiver, it sends that to another receiver. This is like your sender is pushing and queue also pushes that message to that particular receiver. This is a point-to-point message. One message will be sent to one receiver. That way. And there is another way of messaging that's a topic-based, subscribe. Publish and subscribe. This is something like in your LinkedIn. That's where your topics will be having in LinkedIn. So a publisher, the group organizer, can publish any message. So your subscriber or the topic, so your topic will send all the messages to all the subscribers. It will not see any two address. Whoever are subscribed to this topic, the group, if you have any big data related topic, if you subscribe there in LinkedIn, you can find this. So if anyone, the publishers, publishes any message, that will automatically receive that all subscribers don't have any particular two address. This is a publish and subscribe messaging type. Okay. And in the same topic, this based on these topics, the LinkedIn has implemented or designed Kafka. So Kafka allows different sources to push data without worrying about what clients are reading it. So let's say I have different front-end systems that keeps on producing some messages. They keep on producing the messages. They will send the messages to Kafka and Kafka will store them somewhere. And from that, your end clients will read from your Kafka. Here, note that producer will push us the data to Kafka and Kafka stores them, but Kafka will not push the data to anywhere. Kafka will not push data to anywhere, unlike your Flume. So the messages will be there with Kafka and whoever needs those messages, they can pull the messages. That means they can read the messages from there, but Kafka will not push them. They only have to read from them, Kafka. And consumers pull. That's the reason you don't need to worry about speed here. So how much ever the producers are producing the messages, Kafka keeps on storing them in its own file system. Okay. So if you configure a Kafka broker, it stores that in a Kafka broker's its file system, the messages. And whenever the client wants to read them, it has to read. Okay, so there in Flume, if you might have observed, the channel keeps on pushing to sink. Otherwise, channel may get overloaded. It may get overflow, and the messages will be lost in Flume. But here, so this stores in the file system and it keeps on. Of course, there also we have one file channel kind of stuff. But that got lately introduced into the ones. No. Next, so once you have these messages stored in broker, a client can read them at any point of time, either from the beginning or from at a particular offset onwards.
So for how long the Kafka will keep the messages in the local file system?
That's again one another configuration property that we can specify. By default, there will be some time limit. I may need to refer the exact time, maybe 1 hour or couple of hours or something like that. Okay. Or maybe a day or so, something like that. But that is a configurable property, that's for sure. Okay. So
okay.
Yep. Kafka itself is a cluster of brokers which handles both persisting data to disk and serving that data to your consumer requests. Whoever wants to consume that data, it will let that consumer to consume that data. Okay.
That means here consumer always pulls the Kafka to check whether data is available or not?
Correct, exactly. Consumer polls and pulls the data.
How do we know whether the data is present in Kafka or not? Consumer, like?
Only option, you have to check whether you have to keep printing from your consumer, whether it's able to consume it or not.
It's like a file checker, what we do is it every intervals it will keep checking whether there is any file or not, like a file monitor.
You should not treat in terms of files. You should treat in terms of messages, so line by lines. So each line is treated as one message. That line by line it will store into Kafka broker, and from there it will read your consumer. Okay, and maybe for unit testing or real-time testing, we have a couple of testing ones. So one is a console producer, which keeps producing messages to your console. And there is one console consumer. Okay, so to test, maybe if your broker is having data or not, if your broker is having, if you configure your console consumer with that broker, if the broker is having data, the data will get printed onto your console. Okay? And whether your consumer is working or not, you keep your original consumer and you use your, let's say if you want to test your producer is working or not, if your consumer is working, then you can use console producer, produce some messages and see that those messages are receiving at your consumer side of that way. Anyway, we'll see all those things. Okay. Real-time testing. But here now, first to understand the key terminology in Kafka. So the sources, the same source that we saw in Flume, is now producer, and the channel is broker, and sync is consumer. Okay, so processes that publish messages are called producers, but these publishes the messages to a particular topic, as we have seen in a publish publish and subscribe mechanism, semantic, messaging semantic. So they publish the messages to a particular topic. We have to create some topics in the Kafka broker and to one of those topics, to which topic you want to push your message. Okay, to big data topic or machine learning topic or to which topic you want to publish your message in LinkedIn. You can always compare these things with your LinkedIn groups and publishing messages to that. So for that only, this Kafka got implemented from LinkedIn to solve those use cases. Okay. And Kafka is run as a cluster comprised of one or more servers. Each one of them is called as a separate broker, Kafka broker. And from Kafka broker, whichever the machines or the processes that subscribe to these topics and read those published messages are called as consumers. And all the communication between all components is done via a high performance, simple binary API over TCP protocol, which you don't really have to worry about too much. Okay. Now, yeah, this is a typical Kafka is a specialized system and overlaps use cases for typical architecture like front end, some producers producing the messages to Kafka brokers, and from Kafka brokers, some consumers like. So some front end systems or some services producing the messages and storing them onto your Hadoop clusters or any data warehouse or any HBase or anything that wherever you want. Okay, and Kafka producers performance and scale when compared with your typical message brokers like RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, these things. Okay, when a batch of 50 messages or these things, so these many messages per second, it was able to process Kafka. Kafka's graph is always at very high level. Whereas your ActiveMQ and RabbitMQ are at these numbers. And similarly, this is the performance scale for your consumers. And obviously, if you check here, messages per second, it's around like 20 to 25,000 range. Whereas producers, almost like 5 lakh or 4.5 lakh on an average, 4 lakhs above, 0.4 million. So here your consumers may not be as fast as your producers. That one thing that you can keep in mind. That's why you have your brokers configured onto your file system and the messages will be persistent there. And those things can be read even slowly by your consumers, because consumers will be the consumer end will be integrated with one of the processing engines generally. That's why the consumers may not take as fast as your producers producing like 4 lakhs, but in your real time you'll not. So this is the ideal performance tests, just to considering the producer and just considering the consumer. This is the peak levels that they can support. Okay, but in your case you might not send this 4 lakh messages per second unless until it's a big fancy company like either Twitter or Facebook or Yahoo. Okay, in your typical these things you'll not find that much. And whenever you run your Twitter examples, you should not expect that all Twitter messages will be, only 5% of the firehouse will be routed to your sample dev accounts. Okay. And Kafka achieves its speed its throughput and low latency, primarily from two concepts mainly. You don't need to worry these things. Majorly, like, so it uses underlying Linux file IO copy mechanisms, zero copy IO using Senfile, and implements Linux Senfile system calls, or heavily relies on Linux page caching mechanism, underlying concepts. Okay. And batching of individual messages to amortize network overhead and append consume chunks together. Instead of sending one message at a time, it's when producer producing or while pulling the messages, it can batch the individual messages, batch them, and then append to the broker or consume from that. So that way it achieves the speed. Okay. And this is even more lower level of architecture. So producers, multiple producers producing the messages to brokers, they can get registered with multiple brokers, and to the brokers they will send the messages, and inside the brokers they will have multiple topics, and this topics to particular topics these producers might be producing, and one particular consumer might be listening on a particular topic, only machine learning topic. So machine learning messages only will be coming to this consumer, and this consumer is subscribed on big data or Spark topic. So he will be receiving only Spark related articles or the messages published by your publisher. Now, here the Zookeeper is one again, the coordination service. Once again, here this it plays the same role. Here all the brokers will be registered with the Zookeeper. Producers rely on Zookeeper for three things, mainly to detect the addition and removal of brokers and consumers. So all these brokers and consumers will be registered with the Zookeeper. So Zookeeper will have the list of active brokers and consumers, and triggering a rebalance process in each consumer when the above events happen. Whenever addition of a new broker or consumer happens, so then the balancing might get re-triggered. Maintaining the consumption relationship and keeping track of consumed offset of each partition. So consumer's purpose is different and producer's purpose is different. Producer mainly checks with your Zookeeper to know what are the active brokers that are available to which I can connect with. So Zookeeper will have that list of brokers. And consumers will be consuming the messages from the topic. So one topic by topic, message by message, each, if you observe this dotted lines, each dot as a separate message, if it keeps on consuming them. So at every point of time, the consumer will update the Zookeeper saying that I have read my messages till this offset number in the queue or in the topic. In the topic, I have read messages until this offset number. Okay? So that offset numbers will be stored in Zookeeper. The reason why they are getting stored in Zookeeper is that, so even if the consumer goes down at any point of time, and even if you, after 1 hour or 2 hours, if you bring this consumer back again as active, if you start running this consumer service on this again, then it can fetch, if you give the Zookeeper address, it can fetch the latest offset up to which it has read previously. From there onwards, it can start reading the messages once again. So specifically, when each broker or consumer starts up, it stores its information in a broker or consumer registry in Zookeeper. The broker registry contains the broker's hostname and port number and the set of topics and partitions stored on it. So for brokers, the Zookeeper stores its hostname and its port number and its topic. And inside topics, it can have partitions again. The partition can topic can be split into multiple partitions. And this partition, you should not be confused with your RDD partitions or your MapReduce partitions or your Hive partitions. Here, partitioning means just an English meaning of slicing. Okay.
Shiva, Ben, question, if you want, I can ask later also.
No problem. Yeah, you can ask.
Okay, so that zookeeper thing you are telling, active, it's like one active broker. So when you say active, that means one type of broker, active broker, like SDFC broker, active broker, or Spark as
active broker. No. Broker means it's one of the service that will be running, server that will be running on. Typically, broker means one machine on which Kafka server is running. Okay.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. So all those will get registered with your Zookeeper services. Zookeeper might be running on a different machine or on the same machine. With Zookeeper, the same purpose of maintaining Zookeeper in HPE, where all your master machines will get registered with Zookeeper, right? If a client wants to connect it to HBase, so client might not know what is the master. But if you connect to Zookeeper will elect one of the masters registered into this as an active.
Basically, what I wanted to ask is, so at a time, there would be only one active broker.
No, not like that. Here okay. It is not like that. Here, okay. All of them are active brokers. Here, okay. You don't. See, this is why, like, this is a publish and subscribe mechanism. There won't be one topic. There can be multiple topics, multiple brokers. Multiple brokers you achieve to have multiple parallelism. That's it.
Okay. So, there might be many active brokers.
Yes, many brokers. Okay. Typically, in your clusters, you might see... On a 20 node cluster or so, you might see two or three brokers setting up.
No, this is slightly different. I mean, until now, Zookeeper is for electing one leader, something like that, right?
So, no, here like, it's not for electing a leaders. All of them are like, hey, all of them are like, here you don't need a core kind of stuff. You don't need a leader here. So it's just to have a list of brokers. Or even if I have to suppress that active keyword.
Okay.
That's available. Okay. It actually maintains two registries. Zookeeper maintains two registries. One is a broker container registry, and second one is a consumer offset container registry. So I hope you got that consumer container offset registry. Every consumer will be updating its offset in that registry. And whenever if it wants to refer that offset, it can refer from there. And similarly, the broker container registry will contain all the registered brokers with this. And what are the port numbers? And what are the topics that these brokers are having? And what are the partitions that those brokers are having? So if it is having that registry in this, whenever producer wants to produce some messages, first, if it wants to produce, get Kafka broker address into which broker you want to send. Just to one broker or two brokers or three brokers. How many brokers you want to send. So get those broker addresses. Once it gets the broker addresses, then no more connection, no more help needed from Zookeeper. Then let's assume it fetched three brokers and it is streaming its data to those three brokers now. Okay. Initially, these brokers got registered with Zookeeper and producers fetch that information and start streaming the data to the broker. So this is the first half. Now coming to the second half, the consumers are registered or fetching or pulling the data from a particular broker. Here, this time you have to give your broker address to which broker you have to configure. You have to listen on which topic you have to listen on. And while listening, or while pulling those messages. So they use Zookeeper to update their offsets till where? they have read their messages, till where they have fetched their messages.
Zookeeper fails?
If zookeeper fails, so that's why generally a zookeeper will be running on multiple machines.
Same zookeeper?
It's a combined service. A service that runs on all the machines.
There would be some checkpointing or something like, right? So it can switch over to other zookeeper.
Yeah. We don't really need to worry much about this because this is a more of kind of reliable, and its purpose itself is to provide you fault recovery or fault tolerance. If it itself fails, means we really need not to think that level, because this zookeeper, if you observe any time in real-time clusters, this zookeeper service will be running in almost all the machines, or all the machines, but so one of them, few of them as elected as a quorums out of them. Okay. So the general purpose of zookeeper maintenance is to provide high availability, but here in our case, it's to register all the brokers and provide the list of brokers addresses to. Both the purposes are there. Like, so if you have a replication, one of the broker goes down, your zookeeper points to the other brokers. We'll see that in tomorrow when we practice those, push those messages, we'll observe that. I will try to kill some brokers and show you how fault recovery can be achieved with replication on this broker circuit. Okay, so this is a bit high level architecture.
Shiva, do you have any video like which you have the one flume video? If you have it, is it possible to share the one scoop and flume if possible?
Let me see that, Mamta. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
So, yeah, and each broker you'll have a different topic. Machine learning is another topic. One topic some users got subscribed to, and Spark is one topic that users got subscribed to, and similarly, Big Data is another topic. And inside the topics, so you can have your data split into partitions, messages. So topics are broken up into ordered commit logs called partitions. Each message in a partition is assigned a sequential ID, which is called as an offset. That is what is tracked by your consumers. Data is retained for a configurable period of time. This is what I was telling you. Once the data is written into a topic or a partition inside the topic, so that will be retained for a configurable period of time. Okay? And if you have a partitions, so most of the times, if you need the message, if you are not worried about the receiving of those messages order, then I would recommend to have multiple partitions. Otherwise, always have one partition. The reason is your producer can, if you specify, if you split your topic into partitions, your producer may produce your messages to any of these partitions. So some messages to this partition, and some messages to partition 2, and some messages to partition 3 under the same topic. Okay? And your consumer also, where it is not worried about the message order, then it, but you don't want to lose fetching the data. So that's the case. Your consumer will start fetching the messages from each one of these partitions and maintain the offset for each partition separately, so that even if it fails, it can read from that message. But when you need the order of these messages, at whatever order the messages were produced, in the same order if you want to process them, obviously it's recommended to maintain only one partition. Okay, so ordering is only guaranteed within a partition for a topic. To ensure ordering, group messages in a partition by key. So configure exactly one consumer instance per partition, one consumer instance per partition within a consumer group, and only one partition. So messages sent by a producer to a particular topic partition will be appended in the order they are sent. So if you maintain only one partition, you will get in the same order. A consumer instance sees messages in the order they are stored in the log. For a topic with replication factor of n, Kafka can tolerate up to n minus 1 server failures without losing any messages committed to that log. Okay. Topics can and should be replicated. More than can, the recommended is should. Topics should be replicated. And the unit of replication is the partition. So if you have one partition, that will get replicated into multiple partitions. Each partition in a topic has. So if you, the replication happens, if you specified it as only one partition, and if you enable the replication, so it will have three replicas. Each partition in a topic has one leader, and zero or more replicas based on the replication factor that you have specified. And so we call these replicas sometimes in sync replicas. Maybe in 5 to 10 minutes, I will wrap up. So what I'm trying to say is, I want to handle these exam or all the practice things tomorrow. Yeah, maybe I'll stop after this slide. Okay, so just let me introduce you to the replication, and then I will stop it here after this. Okay, so after the current slide, I will stop you. Okay, so each partition in a topic may have one leader and zero or more replicas. That means a partition can be replicated. A replica is called as a in-sync replica or ISR when, if the replica can communicate with Zookeeper, if all the three replicas are able to communicate with the Zookeeper, and the replica is not too far behind the leader. That means the leader replica is having 100 messages and leader is having 100 messages and the replica is having just 50, then it is too far behind the leader, right? Then it is not called as in sync replica. It is just a replica, but not in sync replica. In sync replica means that should be in sync with the leader. So if leader is having 100 messages, at least it should have 95 to 99 or 100 messages in that replica as well. Okay. So the group of in sync replicas for a partition is called ISRs. The replication factor, once set up, cannot be lowered. By the time already the partitions might got created. That's what I'm trying to say. One, when you're creating a new topic, that time you may specify the replication. You can lower your replication factor. Otherwise, once at the time of topics creation, if you set a replication factor as 3, so any messages, any partitions will be written into that. You'll always be having 2-3 partitions there. Okay? And tomorrow we'll see how to set up your Kafka on your machines and how to create a topics and how to produce messages and how to consume them. How does this fault tolerance happens, and some real time use case around that I will try to show you. Okay, and a programming touch also. Okay, programming touch also for the producer and consumer side. Consumer side, I always recommend to integrate with Spark and use the Spark streaming there to fetch the messages from Kafka. Okay, we'll see the remaining things tomorrow. We'll try to wrap up tomorrow Kafka. Okay. So today is just I gave you an introduction to Kafka. You can think of these things again, and you can come back to with questions on Kafka tomorrow. We can discuss all of them.
Shiva, are batches also configurable?
Batch size is configurable in Kafka, right? I don't know, in Spark streaming, right? How many seconds?
No, in Kafka also you have shown some in performance, some batch 50, batch 1.
Oh, where is it? I think it's got stuck. Okay. Where are you seeing the batches?
You have shown the graphs.
Oh, that's a batch of 50. Okay. Okay, so batch of 50 messages. Generally, it uses, that's what I was telling, right? When it's sending the messages, it internally uses a batching mechanism. We don't need to specify that. The configuration parameter, by default, producer sends the messages as a batch of 50 at a time, instead of one message at a time. And the same way, from broker, consumer can pull messages as a batch. It's like a buffer, you can say, while file reading. So buffer space, right? Into
okay.
A file, right? That way.
Okay. Kafka is always be used in combination with Zookeeper?
It's not in combination. We should not say like that. Kafka is dependent on Zookeeper. It's not you decide that combination with Zookeeper you use. It's always dependent on that. Kafka cannot run without Zookeeper. Same way as HBase cannot run without Zookeeper, right?
Okay, then who will maintain the offset values and other things? You mentioned
offset
that those
values,
things.
Offset values will be registered in Zookeeper.
In absence of Zookeeper, who will maintain that?
That's what I'm telling. Without Zookeeper, you can't run your Kafka. It's a dependent. It's a dependency, I should call it.
Okay.
Then used in combination. Used in combination, you can say that Spark Streaming. Kafka used in combination with Spark Streaming, but it is not having any dependency. Without Spark Streaming also, it can run. I mean, whatever you said is correct. I was just trying to correct that sentence. That's it.
Okay.
Your understanding is correct. I was trying to correct that sentence. You should not say like in combination. You should call it as a dependency. It's a must, I'm telling you.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Any more questions? Okay. Thank you, guys. Then let's meet tomorrow morning at the same time, and let's target to finish the Kafka. Okay. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.